as promising disruption in healthcare, but also potentially better patient care. Joining us now, someone on the forefront of this revolution, Roy Jakobs, CEO of Royal Philips. He's based out of the Netherlands, but is in the U.S. for the annual meeting of the Radiological Society of North America. So you can see where we're going with this. And that is whether machines and AI can be better than a doctor at all these subjective diagnostic things that, we worry so much. I've always wondered, would I rather have a false positive or a false negative? I think I'd rather have... I don't want either. I don't want you to miss something, but I don't want you to tell me that I got like 6 months to live unless, you know, unless I can't pay you, then you give me a year. But will it be better or do you need a doctor?
It's really exciting to be here, so thank you for having
Welcome.
Me. And it's an exciting time in healthcare because we see many challenges and opportunities. I think everyone who walks into a hospital feels it, sees it. And AI can actually really make a difference. And I think it's not competing with the caregivers or the people in hospital, actually supporting them, but we need to look for with our innovations. And actually what you saw at the imaging show that we were, and that I'm just coming from, is actually that a lot is happening already today that helps caregivers, whether it's a doctor in better diagnosis, whether it's the technician in first time right positioning with the help of AI, or whether it's a nurse in giving her time or him time back, spending more time with the patient because we can do some of the reporting that they need to do. On average, a nurse spends 20 minutes on admin tasks an hour. And actually that we want to reduce to 5 minutes. And there AI can really make a meaningful difference.
Think about histological studies or cytological studies where you have to send it out and someone has to get it under a slide, look at it, interpret whether you see squamous or I know something about these things now as you get a little older, but squamous or basal. And if you could just plug it in to AI, you'd know immediately. And then even the surgeon would know whether he had to remove more. Or...
No, I agree. And it goes fast. And a great example is pathology. Right?
Pathology.
We use a lot of slides that we look at to kind of do analysis, but slides are very hard to put AI on. So you need to first digitize. So there's a real current revolution going on where we are digitizing pathology.
And Philips is doing that,
and we're doing that with NYU Langone. They are actually really doing that at scale. We are their partner. They're also combining it then with other data sets so that you can really get a full view of the patient, and you can come to better diagnosis for treatment of cancer and can do it faster and even better.
You know, no question, Roy, that this is needed. You can understand how this would make a huge impact in a hospital setting like that. But hospitals don't have a lot of money. Most of them operate on profit margins of 1-2%. There are expectations that that will even get squeezed tighter next year with changes that are expected to come down the pikeway. Everybody looking for ways to cut out waste and fraud. Some of that waste has been supplementing the hospitals to some extent. So what happens? Where's the money in it? It's not cheap to do this, to digitize and set up.
No, but I think at the same time, you see that a lot of what AI can do is actually help you to drive productivity. Mm-hmm. So whilst we, and at Philips, we're looking at, in essence, in a simple way, delivering two things. On one hand, better care. That's what we're talking about. How can you actually use the power of data and AI to come to better diagnosis, to better treatments? But the very important other side is how can you actually give better access to care in an affordable way? And there actually AI also comes to help. And I'll give you a few examples. There's a huge overload on imaging need currently. There are patients waiting to get scanned. Mm-hmm. So we developed an algorithm called Smart Speed that actually has 3 times faster scan time. So you can actually double the amount of patients you can do in the same hour that you could do before. Which actually means that for a hospital, they can treat more patients, they can generate more revenue.
More revenue for more customers.
And they don't need to buy necessarily a whole new MR. They can install an upgrade with an AI kind of algorithm.
How much money do you need up front to implement some of these changes? Upfront fees that maybe pay off over time. I don't know how much time.
We are flexible in the business model. So actually, sometimes you don't need any upfront payment. Mm-hmm. It's just a pay as you go or pay as you consume. In imaging, for example, it's very common that also you pay per study or per report, which is also how the system gets reimbursed. So actually we tie and also look to how can we really bring affordability. I give you another example of affordability. So we have come up and we presented the next Blue Seal MR. Mm-hmm. That is a helium-free MR that actually has a total cost of ownership that is 40% less versus a traditional MR.
Those are expensive, right.
And that's a massive saving over lifetime that we are driving, and that actually is a combination of hardware evolution, but also AI that you deploy in the workflow. Mm-hmm. Because the big savings to be helping the systems with is how can we make more efficient workflows.
Sure.
And take routine tasks out and deploy AI. Give you 25% of scheduling drops out. So in the patients that kind of do not show up, that's a massive loss of productivity right there.
Right.
We can help hospitals with latest kind of AI to actually fill that very quickly so that they can make sure they get the best volume load and the best revenue generation
that's
capacity.
Great.
I mean, I would think like so many things that doctors and caregivers and nurses shouldn't worry about being displaced. They should worry about being able, or they should be happy that they'll be able to focus on more productive things than some of the menial things that they've been doing.
We are very passionate about giving time back to the caregivers. And that's actually where technology really can help. Because as you say, for me, we are not competing with people or caregivers. There are a huge shortage of those. And we expect that shortage will also and only increase towards the future. Because demand is going exponentially up, and we just don't have enough doctors, nurses, and technicians. So actually, we need to help to close that gap with bringing technology forward that can take tasks away. As I just mentioned, the reporting, some of the diagnosis where you can actually do pre-populated reports, but also when a radiologist needs to actually report back, they currently need to make specific reports. They need to use a lot of time for that. We can actually do that automatically. We had a Gen AI application that we showed that actually on voice dictation immediately puts up the report. Then the radiologist only has to validate, and then they can go back into talking to the patient, explaining actually what the diagnosis is about, because that's actually where real value is also created in making sure that patients understand that the right diagnosis is done. And so I think you see a lot of advancements along the workflows where we can do this. Another example is with children. We have a great collaboration with Nicholas Children's Hospital, where we're looking at how can we make the experience for children better by using technology. That is creating an ambience in which they feel more at home when they have to take a scan. That's actually shortening the scan with the help of AI so that actually they can do it faster. And then also with the outcomes and the readings, how can you get the best outcome supporting AI? So you can look at all the different steps, both for the patient and the clinician, to make it a better outcome.